So, welcome everyone, good evening again. This is Jeleni Polska webinar series. Initially, we have aimed to make this only for internal use to train members of Jeleni in topics around food sovereignty, topics around networks of collaboration in Europe, campaigns, etc. Because we're organizing a Food Sovereignty Forum in January, we thought that this is a really good opportunity to meet already before the forum and also to come to the same page about the topics. So today we have a great pleasure to host Ramona Dominiciu. Almost there. Can you pronounce your surname?
Sure, Ramona Dominiciu is my name. Actually, my name comes from Sunday. In Romania, in Romanian, it means something like Sunday.
Ah, okay. So, Ramona Dominiciu.
Yeah. Don't worry.
And today's topic is what is really the role of Eastern Europe in the global movement of La Via Campesina, and specifically, what are the prospects looking at Poland and Romania to really push the agenda of small farmers and peasant farmers of agroecology and food sovereignty within a wider politics of food and agriculture system? You have probably read Ramona's biography, but I would really love to invite Ramona to introduce herself and tell us a little bit about what she does. Then follow up with her presentation. I think the way we'll structure it today is around maybe half an hour talk from Ramona.
No, please go ahead, sorry.
And then we can have more of a discussion between ourselves and ask Ramona questions. If you have any questions in the meantime, you can write them in the chat or raise your hand. So I'll stop screen sharing. Over to Ramona, and I will now switch off the views.
So thank you, and hello to everybody. Very nice to, always a huge pleasure to talk to people that are peasants or farmers or interested in food sovereignty and that are living in central Eastern European region, because our region indeed, it's a very important one. It's a crucial region for the continuation of peasant farming in Europe and for the realization of food sovereignty in Europe. We here in Romania are absolutely convinced of that. So who am I? I'll start with that very briefly. I'm a peasant. I'm based now in Transylvania, where I have a tiny farm. I am born and raised a peasant. For many generations, my family has always lived from the land, worked and ate from the land. We've been peasants since we can trace back our ancestors. And I've been involved for a long time in the anti-mining peasant movement in Romania, in a social and environmental struggle called Save Roșia Montană. And back in 2009, peasants and activists decided that it's time to create a platform, an organization for peasants, where peasants can politically express themselves and can promote their interests and agenda, because obviously, being in a Eastern European country with a young democracy and with a government that had a little experience in exercising and promoting democratic values, and of course with a very long history of corruption and so on, and actually a totalitarian regime before 1989, we decided that nobody can represent the interests of peasants better than peasants. So we also looked around Europe and the world, and to see what is out there. And we discovered La Via Campesina. We discovered the first. We were very attracted by their values, their messages. They almost looked like we wrote them. You know, it's because after also other further years of working together with La Via Campesina, we realized that peasants all around the world are the same. They have the exact same problems, and they're united by the same values, we share the same principles, and so on. So yeah, in 2009, we created the Eco Ruralis, this peasant organization, who in 2011 became a member of Via Campesina Europe. Via Campesina Europe, and then when there was the General Assembly of La Via Campesina International, we were also recognized as full rights members by La Via Campesina in general as well. That happened in Jakarta 3 years ago. Okay, so for a long time, it took us a long time, I should say, to relate to a wider context other than our national context that we were very familiar with, and we were struggling to articulate ourselves to. We knew the political program proposed by all the parties that went through the government was not good, but we needed to also examine and say why, with our own words, with our own thinking, coming from our own reality. Yeah, this is an ongoing process still, but asking these first basic questions of what are our priorities, what do we need to be able to exist, what are the elements and the resources that enable us to survive. Why do people like peasant food and so on? What do we want from democracy and things like this? We asked ourselves big questions, but also concrete questions. Our first, how should I say, priorities were based around seeds, around land, defending our land from industrial projects, from private investors who come and who transform land in the market and who then who commodify land and make it inaccessible for the local communities, for young farmers, for young peasants, and so on. Is this still? Am I still on the in the webinar? I'm seeing yes, a little logo.
All is good. We can hear you well.
Okay, so we step by step articulated. In the first phase of our articulation, we did not realize that what we are doing is that we are actually articulating ourselves inside the big project of La Via Campesina, which is food sovereignty. And little by little, we also discovered this political project, the food sovereignty project. And we absolutely fully recognize ourselves in it, because what is food sovereignty? It is basically an alternative to the existing framework, the existing framework being the food security, to solve the problems created by food security, but also to support and transform rural areas into not just surviving areas, but areas that are doing well, that are prosper, where people are able to feed themselves and to feed their communities and their countries. And the most important element of food sovereignty is that the ones who work the land also take part in the decision-making process, but not as in a scheme of stakeholders, like they are one of the consulted parties, but in the center, they have the most important voice as the ones who are benefiting, the first ones to benefit also from the effects of policies regarding food and agriculture. This is something that this kind of shift of the paradigm, that is something that we consider that it's necessary, because now the decisions are taken by less and less actors. And there is an increasing problem of governance around the world. A huge interference in the governance by the private sector, by multinational corporations. And we see, you know, through various means, we consider that the governments need to reconfirm their commitment for human rights and for giving people the power to be part of decisions. Otherwise, going on the path of capitalism as it is laid out right now will only undermine the role of government and will create these superpowers, super financial powers, which are now representing corporations and mega corporations, and with all of these huge mergers that were seeing around, and we have plenty of examples in Europe. You see Bayer and Monsanto and so on. We clearly see a tendency of transferring the decision-making power from governance and from institutional level to the private sector, to big corporations. And when corporations have the power, the interest is mostly financial. It's not really human rights based. It's not doesn't really care about the environment. Doesn't really have social or cultural values. So, you know, in this big scheme of things, where La Via Campesina is engaged in various political projects, various political processes, in numerous international treaties, in order to realize this the food sovereignty. We also believe that Eastern Europe has a huge role to play. First of all, Eastern Europe has been absent for too long in international processes for too long. First, it's been our governments who are completely absent from you know, the political decision scene around the world. I have seen it. I can say that I have seen it repeatedly in the FAO, in the EU, in Geneva, in the Human Rights Council. Eastern European countries are always silent. They claim they don't have enough resources. They don't understand also most of the time the discussions and the mechanisms. But this is why I think this is a great opportunity for us, the peasants and the people, to show our government direction. And I would like to share with you a tiny little sketch, so that you understand a little bit the complexity of political work of La Via Campesina in general. And then we're going to talk a little more about, we're going to focus more on Europe and, of course, on Eastern Europe. But I would like you to, where is it? Ah, yeah. How do I do this sharing of share screen? I can share. Is that that's okay? No, I can share this picture.
Yeah, go ahead. Share, click share screen, and it should show for us.
Okay. Okay, share screen. Oof. Okay, and share screen. I should share. No. Yes, here. No. I'm really sorry about this.
It's right in the middle on the bottom, share screen.
Yeah. But I want to share a share screen. I'll do it again. Okay, I'll do one more time. This one. Here it is. Can you see it?
Mm-hmm. Great.
Okay, so this is the picture that I wanted to share with you. It sums up all the political processes that La Via Campesina is participating in. We don't work alone. We work through an alliance called the International Planning Committee for Food and Agriculture, Food Sovereignty, I'm so sorry. International Planning Committee for Food Sovereignty. And
Ramona,
you see, yeah?
I think you can use your mouse to show us like the name.
Oh, yeah. So yeah, I'm sorry. Okay, here it is. The name, it's written wrong. I don't know how I managed. It's the website is foodsovereignty.org. So this alliance is it's an alliance that represents over 300 million peasants and indigenous people and fisher folks. From this alliance, La Via Campesina is the largest movement, the largest social movement. La Via Campesina represents over 200 million peasants, peasant families all around the world. It's represented in all the continents. And we are allies here with six constituencies of, as I was saying before, indigenous people, fisher folks, pastoralists, and we are supported by NGOs, by international NGOs in our work. And I mean, you can discover this is the logo of the alliance. You can discover more on the website. And you see here this triangulation between these three power centers, Rome, Geneva, and New York. Rome is the place of the Rome-based agencies. FAO is one of them. You probably heard of FAO. It's the most well-known agency that works on food and agriculture of the United Nations. You have also IFAD, which is the second agency that we're involved with, International Fund for Agricultural Development. And there's a third one, but we're not really, so I didn't, it's not mentioned, it's the WFP, the World Food Program. But apart from that, apart from these two agencies, there is the CFS, the Committee on World Food Security, which is basically the space of where legislation, intergovernmental legislation is created. It's we could call it as a parliament of the United Nations that creates legislation on the theme of agriculture and food. It was the CFS who created the voluntary guidelines for responsible tenure of land. You probably, maybe I'm not sure. Maybe you heard of these guidelines. It's one of the most known policy recommendations that were negotiated by the CFS. There is another one that is very well known. It's called the Right to Food. And this policy will be monitored in the next 2 years to check what is the level of implementation of the right to food in the governments of the United Nations. It's a very interesting process, and it's a very good opportunity for us. It offers us many entry points to hold our governments accountable on issues related to peasant rights to seeds. And here we have we have a possibility for the Polish people to push harder the struggle against GMOs in Poland. As I know, this is one of the most dear struggles to peasants and activists in Poland. And we have under CFS here in the scheme, you see something called the CSM, Civil Society Mechanism in relation to CFS. This is how La Via Campesina, as well as other civil society movements and organizations, are able to participate directly in the negotiations in the CFS on the same level with governments. Myself, I am representing in the CSM La Via Campesina. I'm representing the constituency of food producers at a global level, and it's a mandate that I have been invested with since October last year. Oh God, it's not last year already. So October, since 2 months, and it's a 2 years mandate. And I'm hoping to be able to share with you more information about the work that we're doing in the CFS in the future. Let's move now on to the side with the green little, gray little squares. Here we listed the international treaties. The ones on the other side with the white are in policy, the political processes. These ones with gray are treaties. You have here the International Treaty on Plant Genetic Resources for Food and Agriculture. It's a very important treaty in the Article 9. It regulates the right of farmers to seeds, and it's a very important article, and we can and should use it more and more in order to push back against corporate interests, to push for hybrids, to push for genetically modified organisms, and to push for new breeding techniques that are now threatening the European markets. And these are, as Via Campesina say, the new genetically modified organisms. And then under the this treaty, there is another one. It's the Rotterdam Convention. This is more a convention that is related to pesticides in agriculture. And it's more the indigenous people, our allies, who are following this treaty. Not so much La Via Campesina so far. It's also a new treaty. So we still have plenty of time to get engaged in that. I should probably keep going because I don't want to become boring or something. Over there down to the left, you see Geneva, another superpower center. On the right side, you have the United Nations Human Rights Council. And in the United Nations, there are two very big processes that were created and generated by La Via Campesina. On one hand, you have the Declaration for the Rights of Peasants and other people working in rural areas, which is was declared by La Via Campesina in the 7th conference this year as a number one priority at the global level. So this here is the work in which we invest the most energy, time, and resources for the coming year. And on the right side, you see a binding treaty on transnational corporations. This is also another process for negotiating a binding treaty on holding responsible transnational corporations. It's something related to trade that the peasants around the world from La Via Campesina are very concerned about. It's a very difficult process, and the European Union is a huge opponent. As well as the usual suspects, which is the United States, Australia, and even other regions like China and so on. And down below, it's another process. It's called the Expert Mechanism on the Rights of Indigenous People. This is something that the indigenous allies are following more. It's something that they have created inside the Human Rights Council. On the left, you see when we talk about treaties that are based in Geneva, you see the Myanmar Convention on Mercury. This is something that is addressing pollution, mining pollution, a very important treaty that is mostly followed by indigenous people. And then you see under it the UPOV, which is the Union, a treaty that is regulating protection of new varieties of plants. UPOV is also the treaty that that established the standards for registration of seeds. You probably know that every country of the world, most of the countries of the world, have mandatory registration for seeds. If you want to commercialize seeds from the market, for example, if you want to leave from work of seed production, you have to register your seeds in your national seed catalog, and the national seed catalog respect this UPOV standards, which are actually created for hybrids. It's impossible to register traditional seeds because they are not homogeneous, they are not stable, as it's required by global standards. And actually, there's a big question mark if and how would we want to register traditional seeds, considering that the aim of Flavia Campesina is, in fact, for peasants around the world to have the right to freely exchange, use, and ultimately to be able to sell seeds that come from traditional source, that are farm safe seeds, and so on and so forth. So I'll stop here with this details about UPO. WTO, it's underneath. If you didn't know, WTO is actually a treaty. It's so big that it's more like an institution in itself. It has the headquarters in Geneva. And actually, today, they just closed their ministerial meeting. They had a ministerial meeting in Argentina, where we have a lot of peasants from India who are following intensely the problems, not work, we would call them problems of WTO, World Trade Organization. Last but not least is the Convention on Biological Diversity with two protocols, the Cartagena Biodiversity Protocol and the Nagoya Protocol. This is a huge framework for agricultural biodiversity that we've been following for a long time. To close this, triangle of power, New York is the third the part where we have the framework for Framework Convention on Climate Change that organizes all of these COPs. You probably remember about COP21 in Paris that finalized the agreement on climate change. Finally, governments agreed to on this reducing the global temperature by 2% to 2 degrees Celsius. I'm sorry. And recently, the COP23 took place in Bonn. It was a month and a half ago or last month. I'm not so sure right now. And then you have the SDGs, the Sustainable Development Goals, that everybody speaks now about, that are on display everywhere on web pages of the European institutions and governments around the world as well. And then in terms of other processes in New York, we have the Permanent Forum for Indigenous Issues, which is something that has been created by the indigenous people following their negotiation and adoption of the indigenous peoples, the Declaration for the Rights of Indigenous Peoples, which was adopted 10 years ago. And under it, you have the United Nations General Assembly, which is a huge, the supreme space of power, where all the, negotiations will end up. All the results of negotiations will end up. For example, after the vote, hopefully, there will be a final vote on the Declaration for the Rights of Peasants next year. After the declaration will be voted, it will go to the United Nations General Assembly for the final vote. I will stop here. And before I continue with Eastern Europe, I think, oh my God, it's been a half an hour since I've been talking about global issues. If you have any questions right now, and then let's talk about Eastern Europe and about how can Poland and Romania and why should we contribute to this big movement, and how can we change the agriculture and the future?
Great. Thanks, Ramona. Your diagrams are amazing. We got another diagram about European processes from Ramona, so we can also make it accessible later on. So does anyone have any questions? If you raise your hand, then I can put you online so that you're visible as well. I cannot put myself online, but... Or if you have any... I think the real thing about the, seeing how complex all the processes are in one page, it's quite a lot to take in and to even understand how many treaties there exist that regulate some aspect of agriculture or food from sea to trade. It's just...
Yes, I mean... The idea is that if we don't pay attention to global decision making, other people will decide for us, and we are tired of decisions about us without us. What you have seen in there, the fact that La Via Campesina now is so involved in at global level, it's been after many years of struggles. Many years of accumulated experience and collective accumulated experience. It doesn't happen overnight. It's actually something that we peasants from Romania feel grateful to, because it's something that we are joining to a movement that has already achieved some things and is already building to the highest level possible. And it gives us confidence that this is not just about something superficial. It's really serious, and it's we have the courage to join them and to express ourselves, because we trust this absolutely enormous process.
I think this is also something interesting Ramona is saying, that some at the beginning it's been a little difficult for us to get with the idea that it's an opportunity to express ourselves. So when we went with Ecoland to the conference, and even before in some of the conversations that we've had with La Via Campesina and with the Polish farmers, it's been the idea that it's yet another organization that you join. It's different from the one where it's a movement that you join and you really contribute to, and you can use this entire field of relationships and shared experiences to actually build your own understanding of what's going on in your country and then express it well. Someone is asking a question. Wojtek is asking a question. Which of these processes are possible to influence in any way from a national level, if any at all?
All. And I will give you as example the peasant rights declaration process. This process has been initiated 16 years ago by La Via Campesina, and through discussions and very, very slowly, informally. And since 2012, this process has been, became official in Geneva, in the Human Rights Council. The Human Rights Council voted for a resolution that established the creation of an open-ended working group. Okay, this is how it's called. The participants of this open-ended working group are governments. They are the ones to negotiate. They are the ones to cut the text, destroy the text, or improve the text, agree or disagree with the idea of having a human rights advance in such a way. And I've been to Geneva in May, when there was the fourth session of negotiation of this open-ended working group. And I've been a second time during the plenary session of the Human Rights Council in September. And both times, I went to talk to governments. And the first time when I went, nobody ever spoke to Eastern European governments. Nobody. Because... Via Campesina organizations in Eastern Europe are quite new, and we needed some time to accommodate and to understand the political dynamic and what's going on. And we only managed to participate in this process for the first time this year, like this. And the diplomats from Geneva only had the excuses. Ah, we don't have enough people. We are only two or three. We didn't receive. And their first argument was when I was asking, but why didn't you participate to negotiations so far? They didn't even know about the existence of these negotiations. They said we did not receive an order from the capital. And this means that nobody in those Eastern European countries spoke to their governments about this declaration until May, about the fact that in our countries there is a need for such a protection for peasants, that we need the recognition of a peasant rights declaration. And I went to speak with my government. So I spoke to, Georgia, Bulgaria, Hungary, Ukraine, Slovakia, Slovenia, Croatia, many countries. And when I went to speak to my the Romanian embassy, I could hear and I could feel that the ambassador was listening like no other country has listened to me. And for the first time, they sent a delegate to participate, to follow the negotiations. And this happened because somebody from this from my country, okay, spoke directly with the representatives there. And we also sent a letter to the Ministry of Agriculture, but they usually ignore our communication. Also with this, it seemed also super abstract. What do you mean participate in what negotiations? What with Geneva? Like, who cares? But when I went there, and I was in Palais des Nations Unies, it was different. You know, when you speak to the right people, when you actually address. So the influence was that, there was some participation. And then a second thing we did this regional conference in Bucharest on the 15th of November. And we also had the participation of a Hungarian representative. And now there are discussions between Romania and Hungary that they want to take a step forward, and they would like to, to exchange, and they would like to build a position in favor of the declaration. And this is, successes at this level are not achieved very easily, but when they do, they have a global impact. And just imagine what would happen if by the end of next year, somehow we managed to adopted a United Nations Declaration on the Rights for Peasants. It's truly unbelievable. There are 27 articles over there that protect peasants' rights to seed, protect peasants' rights to land, to agrobiodiversity. We would have basically two articles that we can use to push for total ban of GMOs in our countries just by having this declaration. And for sure you can influence. There are extremely technical these spaces, and it's extremely intricate. But I don't know. I hope this example is maybe giving you a good image on how these processes are. How the answer is yes, we can influence them, but it's not a simple yes. It's not a yes that you see, like you're able to see the change in front of your eyes. It takes time.
Great.
And please interrupt me. I might be speaking a little too long. And
we're gonna have another maximum 40 minutes to wrap up the webinar. So you can still give us a little bit more view from your work in Romania and from your work on European level and on the level of global institutions about Eastern Europe specifically.
Yeah.
But just if anyone has a question, then you can write it. There's also a Q&A icon on the bottom. And I just want to say that last year when the group of us were in Cluj-Napoca in Romania at the European Nyelani Forum, there was a presentation by Judith Hitchman. She's from Argency, if I'm correct, where she was also outlining all the different institutions that deal with different areas of food and agriculture system. And when I saw it first time, I was like completely blown away. I took pictures of those slides that she had because it was just such dense piece of information. So maybe you can send us also that diagram so that we can properly look at it.
It's yes, of course.
Take some time to unravel.
Absolutely. With pleasure.
So, and I maybe I'll interrupt you in around 15 minutes, just so that we have some time for discussion, and then we can bring everyone on one screen.
Okay. Oopsie daisy. Yeah. But European level, La Via Campesina has members in 18 countries. We have 27 member organizations, and overall, we have somewhere over 100,000 members. The majority of the members of Via Campesina in Europe come from Western Europe. There are at the moment three members from countries in the East, Eastern Europe, Central Asia, we could actually say. Romania is one. Romania is clearly Eastern Europe. We are, you know, proud also to be considered from Eastern Europe. We also have Georgia, which is borderline Eastern Europe, Caucasian area, borderline with Central Asia. And we have Turkey, from Turkey, another member organization, a very strong and oppressed in the same time member organization. But Turkey, again, it's in a borderline Asia. It's a more interesting space. But with only having three member organizations from Central Asia, at the European level, we have, it's a lot of, we're representing a lot of members, over 100,000, but compared with other regions of the world, Europe has actually much less peasants, because the common agriculture policy had managed to destroy most of the farmers in Europe. And of course, when I say Europe, I refer mostly to Western Europe. The majority of the peasants in Europe are of course in Eastern Europe, Central Europe. Romania, for example, has 50% of the peasants in the, almost 50% of the peasants in of the European Union. And the further east you go, the more peasants you find. Of course, it also depends on whether after the fall of communism there was a land redistribution, or whether the state is still controlling the land and is still the major player on the market. But Romania was one happy case of land redistribution, and we have over 4.7 million peasants in Romania. We have 4.7 million reasons to fight and to, do everything we can to advance with our agenda of food sovereignty, where these people would get more rights and would, get more access to market, would get a better income to live from agriculture, and better means of production. There's a whole series of objectives, long-term, short-terms, that we are articulating by ourselves at national level, but and also with Via Campesina Europe at regional level. Via Campesina Europe has a process of decision-making that is quite horizontal. We have first and foremost the General Assembly that meets once a year. And in January, we will have the General Assembly for 2018. And we are extremely happy to have invited also ECOLAND, the regional organization from Poland, to become a candidate member in Via Campesina Europe. I think, you know, I think that we will be able to strengthen in a much more concrete way by the work together with the Polish peasants. On top of the General Assembly, where all the members usually send around one to three people, it depends on their availability also. On top of that, we have working groups. Via Campesina Europe is organized in 30 working groups. Please don't laugh. It's a lot, of course. There are different kind of levels of priorities also within the working groups. For example, the highest level of priority are represented by the working group on seeds, working group on land, working group on migrants and seasonal workers, the working group on peasant rights, also the working group on the common agricultural policy, agroecology. Yes, that's another very active working group. But we have also other working groups that are not so active. Last but not least, we have a women articulation that is transversal. We believe that women should be present of every topic that we work on. We need to have women in the common agriculture policy, in the seed production, in having access to land, access to market, and so on. I forgot to mention that we have also a working group on markets, and it's quite active, more and more active. And also the question of youth is something that is concerning us, because Europe is a very old continent compared to other continents of the world. In the average age of farmers around Europe, it's around 60, something like that, and it's very worrying. So we consider the question of having more opportunities for young people to install themselves in agriculture as a big priority. As a kind of like executive body, Via Campesina Europe has a coordination committee of 10 people that are elected by the General Assembly. I am also one of these 10 people, I've been elected 2 years ago. The mandates are for 2 years, and my national organization has decided to propose me for another mandate. So next month, I will candidate for re-election. in the coordination committee, and in this whole structure, there is a parity of gender. For example, the coordination committee must have five women representative and five men representative. If we're not able to fill all the, I mean, let's just say, we're not able to fill all the spaces for women, we are not going to have a man in the place of a woman. It's just going to remain vacant, because we believe very much that we need to have spaces for women in order to have real feminism. And we believe that rural feminism is the basis and quite vital for having more rights for women, which is so necessary.
If you want, you can finish. But there's
questions. I like
about, how do the regional Via Campesina agencies get involved in on a global level? So if you could give an example, maybe of how being part of eco rallies, also yourself at the intersection of ECVC and Yeleni Europe, how how a local farmers organization can actually affect any of those global processes. You mentioned one, the Declaration yes. of Peasant Rights. Maybe there's
another. I will give another one. Yeah, yeah. So not agencies, we are regional coordinations. In Europe, it's called the Via Campesina Europe. I mean, European Coordination Via Campesina. In Latin America, it's called CLOC. Coordinación, I don't know what. Coordinación, organizaciones de campesinos, I don't, something like that. In Via Campesina International, there are also working groups, just like there are in, did I say Europe? So in Via Campesina International, the work is also structured in working groups. Via Campesina International has a working group on seeds that is in direct coordination with the working group on seeds of Via Campesina Europe. And for example, when La Via Campesina Europe wants to participate in the ministerial meeting of WTO, we actually, in fact, reject WTO and we don't participate to the negotiations. We go there and we make big protests outside. We create side events and so on. We have a parallel agenda and we try to influence WTO from outside. This is the approach. There is a global call from the working group of La Via Campesina International to the working groups of the regions. Yeah, so the working groups on trade will activate themselves. And for example, the working group on trade from Europe includes active members, people from all the member organizations. And also, these working groups also have to include at least one coordination committee member that has a role of moderation, has the role of facilitation, coordination, and make sure that the messages are passed and so on. And the people from, you know, national organizations can receive these calls. Oh, look, there is this ministerial meeting. We have two places from Europe, two or three places from every region. Usually it's the same number of people from all the regions. And then the group decides, the working group decides, okay, who wants to go, who is available, you know, there is a small consultation. And this is how, and these people, when they participate at global level, they are briefed. They don't go there to represent a personal opinion. They go there to represent the agenda of the whole region. So there is a participation process, the preparation process before, with documents, with briefings, and so on. And I hope this was a good example. Also, in other in the seeds treaty, for example, I was in Rwanda in October to represent Via Campesina Europe in. The governance body, no, the governance session of the seeds treaty. Every 2 years, this treaty has a governance session. Basically, governments from around the world who signed this treaty meet, and they have an agenda. They have working groups. Surprise, surprise! Everybody has working groups, and they negotiate. How can the articles, the various articles of the treaty be implemented or not necessarily improved? Like there is no, sometimes there is also work on the text, rework, renegotiation of the text. But usually this is avoided because it's extremely hard to reach consensus at the global level. But this is the way, by being active. If you're active, it's the sky's the limit.
And the question about consensus came also from our farmers. We had this intergenerational meeting for food sovereignty just about a week ago, 2 weeks uh-huh. ago. And in response to the presentation about Via Campesina, the farmers asked, okay, so how is it possible to achieve a consensus on a global level among 200 million farmers who participate on local. But my question would be to you, in Romania, so some of the comments about how consensus is possible in the Polish culture of collaboration, cooperation, some of the challenges are our individualism and also a kind of maybe habits of working within very hierarchical structures, so not taking our seat, not expressing ourselves fully. So I wonder, how is the process for you in Romania in terms of engaging farmers in this kind of more horizontal decision-making processes, and you know, has it been an evolving process? Where did you start, and where are you now after 4 years of eco rallies?
So without wanting to pretend in any way that there is a perfect example of consensus, I think from our experience, the answers is in a lot of preparation. Because you cannot reach consensus if a lot of people are put in front of a problem suddenly without any previous discussions. Also micromanagement must be avoided. If we get lost into details, we will lose the big picture. For example, the way we are able to reach consensus in the General Assembly on what are our priorities for the next year, or do we want to engage with the Ministry for Agriculture in this matter, or we want to organize this big event and we have to take this and these decisions. The answer stays in the working groups. It's the working groups who offer a lot of solutions, who offer action plans, who propose to the General Assembly a lot of things that are already agreed by a lot of people. And there is also cultivating respect for other people's work, you know. And in general, peasants are very humble people and very, very respectful people. We had also crisis moments when we had, you know, in the beginning, when we had our first attempts to, articulate ourselves in a political way. Peasants were not familiar, were not never put in positions of leadership. So it's very easy to confuse your own opinion with the opinion of a group, and to avoid a process. You know, the key is the process. This is what we've discovered on our own skin, to say so. You need, even if it looks like that is slow, you need a process in place that is adapted to the you know, conditions of the, like, the cultural conditions, the people, the time and place, that is consulting people, that is informing them, that is asking for advice rather than please comment, just comment on this, like say something for advice. Is it good, is it bad? I mean, friendly advice, for we consider ourselves like a family, like brothers and sisters. We're if we're not united, you know, it's we don't stand any chance in front of Monsanto. And I mean, of course, egos and things like this exist. And we did have a crisis where we had to for example remove a member, a representative, from the leadership position, and it had to be done through a process. This happened almost 5 years ago, and we still suffer. I mean, not suffer the consequences, but we still feel the effects of it in a more and more positive way. But if it's done through a process and it's slow and clear, the best way is to use your mind and to discover yourself. What is the process, your own process of reaching a consensus? And sometimes consensus cannot be reached, you know. But you need a process that makes it acceptable for everybody to not reach consensus. So
agree to disagree. And agree to even find any place in the middle.
For example, La Via Campesina organizes the General Assembly every 4 years. We call them the international conferences. And when an international conference finishes, the next one starts. And in between these conferences, there is a preparation meeting, which is a huge preparation meeting because the whole planet has to participate to it. So it's like a mini general assembly in between to make sure that we're still on the same page. And then whatever is approved at the general assembly, it's more formal. It's more because everything has been already worked out. Everything has been agreed in advance through a slow process. It's very inspiring for us. Mm. And it taught us that what happens in between meetings, it's important. The constant communication.
It's actually really, having been to that conference this year with Editha from Ecoland, it's really inspiring to have seen that it's not only a process or a methodology of communicating, but it's really forging a new culture of expressing ourselves, coming to terms with our differences and different points of views. And it's been really amazing. I mean, it's to even consider that it's farmers who often live in places quite distant from one another. So sometimes in the villages,
oh, yes,
distance, and then they come together to negotiate a common position. Maybe in a second, I'll also paste a link to a very interesting process called citizens jury. I don't know, Ramona, if you heard about this. It was I recently watched a documentary about a group of farmers in India who have been asked to listen to all the kind of advisors, NGO workers, local governors, to advise them on what they should do with their land and with their farming. It's around the time where they wanted to do a lot of organic farming for export in India. And so those people listen to everyone, and then they make a very intelligent, informed decision about what is best for them collectively as a community. So maybe I'll paste it in a second. There's another question, but I think what I'll do now is to put everyone back on the screen and unmute us so that we can actually have a little bit more of a conversation, because we have around 15-20 minutes to close, and it would be nice if we just go.
Yes, please. Let's have conversation. I mean, I really hope there is no doubt that Romanian and Polish peasants have so much to contribute to the global conversations and the global strategy of peasants and the global struggle. Most of peasants in Europe are in our region. Yeah, so we have a huge reason, we have a million reason to fight for. Second of all, we've been absent for too long, and we need to mobilize ourselves, and we need to engage with the government. It's the most painful thing, it's not beautiful. We don't have to engage all in the same way. We don't have to necessarily talk to them, but we have to find a way to interact and to influence this space, because agriculture is not just about practice. It's also about decisions, and it's also about legislation. Because these laws come upon us and they affect us. If we want to continue to be able to use our seeds to be free from genetically modified organisms, we need to be there where decisions are taken for us. NGOs are great allies. We need to educate some of these NGOs as well about the importance of having peasants in the center. Because you can't propose to peasants if you don't live the reality, and if you don't understand that if you propose an idea, there are also in the real world on the planet, there are also practical steps to be taken, and somebody who lives in reality like peasants can explain you, look, this is good, this is bad, but the peasant must be part of the process, and it must be in the center, because we must put in the center the effect ones. Peasants feed the world at global level. Most of the food that people consume, over 70%, comes from peasants. And over 80% of the food that is distributed through the market is distributed through local and regional markets, not through supermarkets. even though supermarkets receive absolutely enormous support, supermarkets survive on public money. Yeah, you wouldn't believe. Yeah, they actually don't make money on the so-called free market. I'd rather stop. But I will give an example. You know, Lidl and the Kaufland. You probably know of these supermarkets. They're originally from Germany. They received in the last 10 years 1 billion euro to install themselves in Eastern Europe. They received 1 billion euro from public money from the European Bank for Reconstruction and Development and from the World Bank. And these banks administrate public money. So they gave these funds to Kaufland and Lidl for a project on food security, to ensure food security to Eastern Europe. I mean, I don't know the situation in Poland very clearly, but in Romania, the rate that these supermarkets open open stores, it's grocery stores, it's very alarming. And so we have a big reason to defend our local markets, to defend to defend our rights to access land and so on and so forth. So how would you think that Poland can contribute to the global peasant movement, knowing now a few elements about the global peasant movement from a fellow Eastern Europeaner? What would Poland have to offer to the struggle, to the common movement? I believe there are a lot of peasants and small farmers, sustainable family farmers in Poland, right? And I believe that there are still local markets that where people can find their food that don't exist in other countries, that are specific for Poland, where the food is healthy and accessible, local. Am I wrong?
Nina, you wanted to say something.
And people want to eat healthy and they have this connection. Oh, I'm sorry.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I will not give you the answer because I'm also wondering. I have two questions. Maybe I will ask one and this may be kind of an answer. Because you say that we should cooperate with government, I find it very difficult and the whole lobbying thing. I mean, cooperate in the sense of...
Not cooperate.
Of influencing them, lobbying them. But then it's such a struggle and I sometimes wonder, why don't we just focus on building local alternatives and really forget about the big policy? Because it's the local that we can really influence, maybe the municipality level, maybe that's the limit we can truly influence. What do you think about this?
I think we need to do everything, for sure. We need to build the alternatives, for sure. We need to, continue. First of all, we need to continue to exist and produce food for our local markets, for our families, for our communities, la la la. We need to cooperate. We need to reinvent ourselves when we see something doesn't work. But it's actually, we can't ignore that. The problem is that we cannot ignore the big policy, because the big policy will come and will affect us. And I gave you one example of this, of the supermarkets who come and when they are open, they destroy us. They destroy our markets. In Romania, for example, the big policy has done something quite horrible to our seeds. The Common Agriculture Policy has two pillars. One, it's for direct payments for the subsidies, and the other for rural development. The subsidies, the European subsidies, are now offered to Romanian farmers only if you buy your seed. So in the file for subsidies, you have to include the invoice of seeds. Mm-hmm. So you cannot reuse your seeds. you cannot use the seeds of a neighbor that you received or you bought from a neighbor who, of course, because doesn't have a seeds registered, is not gonna, you know, be able to fiscalize himself and stuff like that. It's a local economy, a local informal economy. Your seeds must be from Monsanto. Only Monsanto can make money officially on the market, and only Monsanto seeds can be subsidized. So the big policy is coming wherever we are, whether we are in the top of the mountain or we are in the plains. It's going to come and get us. So we need to do more than just build on the ground. We need to raise from the ground, and we need to work. And working with governments, it's not something pleasant, and we don't do it alone. We are in a big movement, and we are consulting with each other, and we take it step by step. And you know, we are realistic, and we establish you know, realistic goals in what we are strategic, because we don't have so many resources. We try to use our resources in the most efficient and strategic way, but we can't let them alone. That was my thing. And what was the other question?
So another one is that there's a hidden truth about this subsidies for big corporations, and there is this example of Lidl and Kaufland. There is a second hidden truth, hidden for me for a long time, something that you mentioned, how the common agricultural policy destroyed the small-scale farming. So how do you partner with media, or with whom actually, to reveal this truth, this real impact of these big policies?
When we started working on land grabbing in Romania, we did not think about a media strategy. We just wanted to do the work. We knew there is land grabbing, and nobody exposed it so far. And we spent 2 years before of documentation before we released our first report. We are actually also lucky to have support members of our organization. We have this category of support members. And there are a few investigative journalists that are members, like supporting members of our organization. So we used their help to be able to understand the web. Because, I mean, when you look at the land grabbing and the capital investment, you see that there are so many thousands of companies that are connected with each other, and you don't understand how the money is moving. It's very complicated. So we did partner. And then when we released the report, we had to do very little for promotion. The media picked it on itself. If the work is good, you don't need a huge campaign. And you know what happened? The media picked it up and did their own. They did their own materials. There were many TV shows about land grabbing in Romania. There were articles, and the media appropriated the topic. You know, we did not try to be the to carry the flag. No, this was something that we started. We know we started, because when we started the documentation, it was. The word was like nobody understood what we meant, and it paved the way for media to do the work. And we believe more in this kind of I don't know if I should call it partnership. We're also trying to avoid mainstream media partnerships, because it's very dangerous. You can't control it. It happened many times, you know, to cooperate for press conferences or for interviews and for TV shows. And it looked, in the end, it looked totally different from what we would have transmitted. And of course, the media also gives nationalistic connotations. It's different. But we prefer to work like this. We do our own work, and then if the media likes it, we send more or less regular. What we do, we send to the media, but we don't insist on it. We don't, I don't know if this is disappointing or not. And you cannot expect for every little action to be interest for the media. For example, we tried very hard to have an article written in the Guardian when we went to the negotiations for the Peasant Rights Declaration in May. I mean, we thought that we would be able to conclude the negotiations, and we thought this is going to be such a big deal. And we were so shocked to hear from a journalist who's actually a good friend of mine that this is actually not at all a story. And we were like, well, what do you mean? This is a... they were like, no, this is... Unless, I don't know, something dramatic happens at the negotiations, this is not a story. This is just a part of a process. So sometimes we also have to accept that, for media, not everything is interesting, and also that not everything the media does is interesting for us.
Great. Thank you for your answer.
Yeah. Go ahead.
No.
I'm just looking at how we're doing with time, and I thought that maybe for the last few minutes, following up everything that has been said, a very rich overview of the processes of political and kind of organizational, what you do to actually move your interests forward. We could just have if someone would like to say what you're living with, what is it that you've learned, or what is it that you're picking to explore further? That would be really interesting to just, if you were confused, share it too.
Yeah, please. Oh my God.
Then we have a little bit of feedback or if you have any feedback, you can also give it to us now. It's these webinars are a bit more informal, so we'll know for the future. Does anyone want to say?
Yeah.
I will unmute you. Nina?
So thank you, Romana, for your presentation. Now I wonder if you have maybe some more document that points the influence of common agricultural policy on the small-scale farming, because I have sometimes difficulties to find the proper source of critique. I know I can,
Yeah. There are materials of La Via Campesina. I mean, I hope they will contain the information that you're looking for. Via Campesina participates in 13 working groups. the omnipresent working groups in the European Commission for Agriculture in a mechanism that is called the Civil Society Dialogue. And these working groups are structured on models of production. For example, working group on milk, working group on small ruminants, the little sheep and stuff. Working groups on wine, working groups on cereals, sustainable rural development, and stuff like that. So when we basically need to structure our work to be able to feed into this this working group, and also to be able to feed now into the process of the reform that started, and which means reaction to the document that the Commission is publishing, letters, various letters to propose our vision to the European Commission. I'm pretty sure we do have analysis of evaluation of the effects of CAP. I can tell you that that Eco Ruralis, my national organization, will start in January to work on a bilan, how do you say, like a evaluation, 10-year evaluation of what CAP did to Romanian peasants. But for that, we need to start a process. We started with some small publications this year, documents, more like working documents for members. And now we are willing to work on something more bigger, where we look together and look at what did it did for sanitary rules, what did it do for the market, access to the market, what did it do for how did it encourage land grabbing, because it actually also encouraged land grabbing, and how did it make our seeds less available on the market, and so on. So we need to work on that, and we would be very, very happy to share that with Polish people, because it would be you guys are going to be able to relate more to the Romanian experience. It's like we are like your little brothers who came a little later in the process and who suffered the same policies like the Polish farmers.
Would anyone else like to add anything? Violetta, I'm unmuting you. One second. I'm having problem with unmuting you. Yes. No. Now it's good. You can speak.
I believe, I know that we can influence government because we can influence each other, other people. Of course, it's a matter of time and a lot of hard work. But what I can see is whole process, I see that something is changing, and to see all of the women as well in this process, for me, so it's a great so I don't have questions. I only wanted to share.
I just want to respond. I of course completely agree with that, and I wanted to say that having us peasants organized to face in a democratic dialogue with not cooperation but dialogue with the government also is building our strength, and it makes us more aware of who we are, because at the moment, if we are not talking to the government, we are mostly their victims of populism. We are their massive maneuver when they have electoral campaigns. We never request for anything, and if we do it, it's not very articulate, and they know that, and they take advantage of that. They use our poverty against us. And they offer us like tiny little nothings. What we want is not their little bribe, electoral bribe. We want to be dignified human beings, respected. We can contribute because we work so hard. We want to be allowed to contribute to the economy. We want to have our status recognized. We want to have a life that is we want to have means that allow us to live a wealth, not wealthy but like good. We want to live good. We don't want to just survive. So it is important to have preparing yourself to engage in a dialogue. It is generating more than just let's say results for a policy. It's generating the consciousness of who you are. So that is why we believe, and we feel it. We feel the difference.
Thank you, Ramona. Now I think we'll be heading towards the close, but I think you've given us such a rich beginning for exploration of other topics that will come up in the following weeks in the webinars. And I think so many more that we could explore. Maybe we can use some of your contacts for getting some of the topics covered, like on seeds, for example. It's a very, very thick and also globally yes. complex topic. I just wanted to show you on the screen as well the upcoming webinars. Next week, I really invite you all. It would be great to see you on Monday. I'll be doing a presentation on peasant agroecology. And this is defined as a practice of food sovereignty. So whereas food sovereignty is this framework that is both, and the concept that is both fostered globally and is a movement, and then agroecology, both urban and rural, is a practice that expresses all the values of food sovereignty. And I will draw a lot from the experience of Scuola Campesina. It was a two-week training that I did in late September in Italy with 15 members of, as you can see on the pictures, of different La Via Campesina organizations or Nieleni organizations from around the world. So here you can see Indonesian
Komar.
Comrades and farmers from SPI, then Salete from Brazil, and here was a friend from Niger. So we will follow up on that topic in the forum. We will have a working group on agroecology and looking at what exactly is the knowledge of agroecology, how can we foster these specific both practices in agriculture and in food systems that are agroecological, and also how can we bring it into wider education and politics. And then already in January, starting from the 3rd, we have a very interesting lecture on the term peasant, farmer. Who is this person? It will be more sociological exploration. We'll have a lecture on ecological folk high school. So a kind of grassroots experiential learning approaches in agroecology that are also fostering attitudes and orientations for collaboration and for cooperation. Then you can see food security and food sovereignty. Food security, and I can't actually say the difference in English, but you can see it in Polish. We'll have Ben connecting the permaculture movement with food sovereignty movement, and lastly we'll have Wojtek, who's also with us here, who will give us an overview of the degrowth movement, so post-wzrost, and how that links to food sovereignty. So we have amazing range of lectures, and perhaps we'll still have someone to come and join us. For now, I thank you all. Thank you, Ramona. Thank you.
Thank you, everybody. Thanks for being up so late.
Yeah, and thank you to the Institute of Global Responsibility, IGO. They've been really supportive in allowing us to now really play with this webinar mode. So yeah. If you have any feedback about how to run it better so that it's more dialogical,
it's very good.
Just write us on nielenipl@gmail.com. Yeah, and next webinars are in Polish. One new message, last message. Thank you. So thank you. I'm ending the meeting. Thank you, Ramona. Bye, everyone.
Thank you. Good evening. And thank you again very, very much. And good luck. Good continuation.
Do register for the Food Sovereignty Forum in Warsaw. The registration is online.
Yeah, we will for sure have at least one Romanian who would come to the forum.
Amazing.
For sure.
Great. See you. Yeah. See you all. Bye-bye.
Ciao.